Welcome to episode 257 of the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
In this episode, we share what's gotten to our tables in the recent spooky season, including some great Thanksgiving gaming. This includes trying Endeavor at higher player counts, a couple of quick-to-learn, quick-to-play card games, and more. Now, those card games were such a big hit with my family on Thanksgiving weekend, including my mom. We're going to actually review both of them tonight.
Before that, some introductions. I'm Sean, your host, and here with me, we have the webmaster and editor, Deanna.
Hello to all my fellow cardboard connoisseurs out there.
And the tabletop bellhop himself, Mo T.
I am Mo Tuzano, the tabletop bellhop, your cardboard concierge, helping you make your game nights better.
We record this podcast live Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern at twitch.tv/tabletopbellhop. And we love it when people take part and join us in the lobby, our chat room. This episode exists thanks to our Patreon patrons and our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild.
You can find detailed show notes for this episode at tabletopbellhop.com/episode257. That's 257. Links in our show notes may be affiliate links, which cost you nothing but support this show.
Now it's time for the Bellhop's Tabletop, where we talk about the games that we've been playing lately.
So up first, we got more Endeavor Deep Sea. Hopefully you're not sick of this game, because I think we're going to be talking about this one for a while. We finally tried it with four players. We played with three and four players. We tried the second mission, and we actually explored some of the bonus content. Now, I want to start talking about more players. So overall, it just makes the game more interesting. Like, there's just more competition for spaces. You're forced to explore and move more. The impact board will fill up a lot more. The competition for spots is a little more heated. You're going to end up with a big pile of 2 points at the end. Overall scores are going to be higher. The majorities are going to matter more. And what I thought was interesting is something we did not see at all when playing with two players, and very seldom with three, is the options become more limited. And that's with the crew, because there are a limited number of each crew type. When playing two player, I could take whoever I wanted. When playing four player, sometimes the one I wanted was gone.
Yeah, there's kind of that race to make sure you have enough pips to get into the row you want to grab the guy you want before someone else takes them all. And the tray, like, there's a giant tray that all the crew members sit in, and you pass it around the table. It's super useful. And there's ones, twos, threes, you know, so many levels that you can get. But the tray is super clever because they all look like there's an equal number of ones to fives, but there isn't. Some of them are more shallow than others. There's a little plastic nub underneath that pushes them up so they're all equal. And I didn't realize until we played with more players that, oh, there's not that many level fours, you know, so you really are fighting over them. Yeah, exactly. It looks like there's a ton. There is not.
Might be three.
It was, yeah. I don't know. I'd have to grab it and look, but it's neat. And as Mo pointed out, it's the same. The tray was also like that in the original Endeavor. Same clever thing they did.
Yeah, it's interesting. The game as a two-player almost feels cooperative. Now, I mean, in general, you are cooperating to help the Earth and help the seas. Yeah. But someone's going to win the game. But there's a little bit more of a cooperative feel to it when it's two players, because there are so many options and you can go off and do your own thing. And everyone's enjoying the oceans on their own almost without all that much conflict. And so it's good to hear that when you do get the player count up, you start to be able to see that conflict if you're playing that way.
It did not feel cooperative to me when I played it versus Mo, but maybe that's because I was just looking for ways to screw him over. I don't know.
It's possible. Now, the one thing that does come with more players is game taking significantly longer. And the big one I can see people complaining about is downtime between turns while waiting for other players to take their action, especially if you've got your turn planned out. Like, if you know exactly what you're going to do, and you're just sitting there going, yeah, I'm going to dive on my turn. And dive takes no time, right? It's like, put a disc, take a token, done. And you're like, okay. And that person's still thinking, okay, they're still trying to decide. Oh, they put a disc somewhere. Oh, they've taken it off. And now they're looking at the reference cards. Now, the game box says half an hour per player, and I can see getting there with enough experience. But at least playing with our family, we're not quite there yet. Now, part of this is just the sheer number of options. Now, at the beginning, like, there's only, what, is it five different options? It's either five or six. There's five different options. They're all pretty simple on their own. But once you got like more of the board explored, there's like, well, I could stay here and dive, or I could move over there and I could use the sonar action, or I could go save those turtles, or I could do that. And the more you play, the more options that actually grow during the game, which is actually part of its strength, is the decision tree gets bigger as you play. But AP prone players are going to have some analysis paralysis.
Sail, dive, sonar, conserve, research. So yeah, five options. Yeah. My mom pointed out that she found in our what did we have, four player game?
Yep.
In our four player game, that by the time it came around to her turn, the thing she wanted to do was always gone. So the thing she had pre-planned had always been eliminated, and she kept having to replan. And she said, you know, normally I like that in games, but for some reason this time it was just annoying the heck out of me. I actually don't find the AP too bad in this one. And I mean, we were playing with our eldest kid, Gwen, who is one of the most AP prone people I know. And there were some long pauses now again, but it wasn't consistently every turn. Like, that's it didn't true. Feel as AP prone as, say, Star Tycoon, which I remember we called out as one of the most AP prone games we had played this year, you know, or a How. Like, those are much more paralyzing games than this one is.
Yeah, a lot of places to go, but again, you've only got five possible options, and depending on what people you have and what tokens you have available, that's limited down even more. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, there's some frustration with losing out the thing you had planned for, but you don't have that many other options to go to if that one was taken.
See, one of the things we did see at four, which we hadn't seen before, is no good action. Like, I have discs left, and I have people. But because of other people taking the stuff, all I have left is I have research and dive, and there's no tokens left, and there's no appropriate colored card out, which we didn't see with the lower player counts. But honestly, I think that's just you need to learn to play better. Like, mm-hmm. you need to move to other parts of the ocean where there aren't other players, so you have options in case people take. So I think that's actually more of a system mastery, learn the game and player skill thing than it is a complaint of higher player counts.
So, yeah, I mean, that happened to me where I had tokens left and I had things I could theoretically do, but could not do them. But each time that it happened, and it was twice in the game, it was my own fault. I screwed right. up. If I had been paying more attention, it wouldn't have happened. So it's just something that it just you need to pay attention. It adds a skill level to the game.
And to be fair, I think we actually, when Mo and I were playing the two-player game, we did have a little bit of that where it was like, oh, the only thing I can do is move, because we had some interesting mm-hmm. choices mm-hmm. come up when we were laying out the board and expanding the board. Not the best things came up. There was only one option for, you know, saving any friendly animals. And so towards the end of the game, there was a little bit of, well, I can do something, but it's not really something I want to do. I just mm-hmm. have to move because that's what I got to do, sort of thing.
Please note, Sean just implied we only save the friendly animals. We do not conserve the other ones.
No, in that game, literally, there was one tile that came up where you could conserve. There was mm-hmm. one spot we could conserve the entire game. But if you wanted to go diving, my God, you could have had any number of tokens.
So there's an otter tile. Did Sean see the otter tile? That is a question that I...
No, not yet.
Yeah, all right.
No. So I got to say, I think I enjoyed it a bit more with three than four, but three was definitely better than two. Four wasn't bad, but like I said, it felt a little long. And well, we haven't even tried five. Now, five is one of those not included in the box. Like you had to back the Kickstarter to get the deluxe edition to play with five. And it does add this like weird edge tile that you add at the top of the board to fit more stuff. So I don't know how that's going to happen. So I got to say that I have a feeling that five's going to be for those groups that get together and there's five of us and we all must play together. And we also want to play Endeavor, so we're going to all play Endeavor together, as opposed to, hey, I'm going to set up an Endeavor night and invite some people over. I'm probably going to stop at three or four.
See, it didn't feel too long for me at four. It just felt just right. Like I could tell as we were playing, I was looking at you and I could see that you were getting antsy, but I think it's because you were hoping to squeeze in more and more game that night. I was having so much fun with that game. It felt like very satisfying. Like it ended not too early, not with me going, oh, I just wanted to run my engine or do a thing, right? And it didn't feel like it ran too long.
I just want to say that the Board Game Geek community also thinks that three is the best choice. While two and four and solo are all recommended, three has stood out as the best
player count.
Like, I'm assuming it doesn't have too many votes yet because people are just getting copies of this.
There was actually more than I expected. 22 votes on a single on a recommendation isn't too bad. Player counts don't get that many votes.
So in our last couple of plays, I've tossed all the bonus material in, which is just more map boards that could come up while you're playing. So far, the only one that's actually come up in our games is the Orca reintroduction tile. So it's a quick little short review on that. I did enjoy playing with it. Besides having awesome little animeeple, the mechanic is that you can stop there, pick up an orca that you can then later release to take a free conserve action, which by free, I mean, you don't have to pay the research cost. You still need the discs and all the other stuff. And that just, I don't know, it felt good. It was like a positive expansion. Like mechanically, it's a solid bonus. Like not having to have the research to conserve is pretty good. But then you are spending a turn having to go get the whale. So there isn't, it's not overpowered. Thematically, it just felt appropriate. You go, you pick up a whale, then you go to an established habitat and release it, which just kind of fits. And I kind of like the fact you're putting the orcas all over the board to show that there's already an orca in this area, so you can't go there and just, you slowly see your board filled with orcas. And it just, I don't know, it felt good. It was like a feel-good expansion.
Yeah, the orca thing was neat. It's not must-have or anything in my opinion, but it was neat.
Yeah, does it have orcas attacking like rich people's yachts? Is that
no? This game has no conflict.
That's even the sub expansion. It's not out yet.
Conflict. So I gotta say, if you have that mini expansion, toss it in there. You could probably even do it on game one. Also, if there ends up being a way to pick up this one, which I don't know, like if you have the retail version of the game, non deluxe, this may be worth finding. Like, it seems like the kind of thing you'll probably be able to get at cons, or maybe Board Game Geek will throw it in the Geek store. And if that's the case, I think it's a good pickup, especially at a con, right, where you're not paying for shipping.
Interestingly, there are no expansions listed under the Board Game Geek thing, so it's all in the box or not at this point.
I tried to figure that out, and I didn't see an actual answer. So we should just ask Mark. Overall, my thoughts just keep getting better. Second scenario did feel quite different from our first. Our scores were much higher than earlier games. I love that feeling of exploration. The most fun part about this game to me is take the sonar action and look at new stuff. Though I got to say, now after three games, I have seen most of the boards in the game. Now, it's not terrible, but I already kind of missed that seeing new tiles aspect of the game. And yeah, that's going to wear off at some point. And there's still a ton of them. We've yet to see a full board, though we were one tile away in our last game.
I love this game. I'm totally hooked on it. I can't wait to try another scenario. I'm going to add, the first time we talked about this game, I talked about how tiny the icons are. If I sit at the right spot on the table, I can play. But I will say that the icons are small enough that my mom and even my daughter, who wears glasses, both said if they sat at the wrong spot on the table, they were also, you know, for the ones for the ocean tiles that were laid out the furthest possible away from them, which would be five tiles away, stuff was small and hard to make out. And you had to constantly ask someone else, hey, what is that on there? There's no way. You can tell it's a conserve action, but you can't tell how much research you need to put down on that conserve action. You have to be able to ask people. So I love the game. If the tiles were any larger to make those icons bigger, the it would become such a table hog. Right now it's a nice table size. It's not ridiculous. So I still have mixed feelings on that aspect.
I almost feel the best way to play this would be on a smaller table, like at your mom's, remove the leaf in the center, and then have us have all our player boards on like side tables. That way everyone could be closer to the main map. In. Or I don't even know, like have the map on a Lazy Susan so people can turn it. So they can kind of see closer.
It would have to be a colossal Lazy Susan.
Oh, I'm sure it would fit on our Lazy Susan. I don't think the map itself doesn't get that big.
Ours is colossal. Most people don't have one that's the size of a vagina. You know, I've seen tables the size of that Lazy Susan.
Yeah, that's true. Now, the other thing we did was celebrate Thanksgiving over at Brenda's place, where she always puts out an awesome spread of food. We spend time with the family and often fit in some games. Now, my mom joins us for this, and I am happy to say we even got her playing this year, which is actually an achievement. Now, I did stack the deck, pun intended, because I know I can get my mom to play card games. So I grabbed two card games from the pile of shame, and we tried out both of them that ended up being really good. And it ended up for a great night, nice and casual and relaxed, and everyone was able to pick up the games and enjoy them. Now, it was my mom who actually suggested we stay late and play just one more round at the end of the night, which doesn't happen often at all.
Yeah, clearly Mo picked just the right games. It super amuses me when she goes from no games, I do not like games, you guys play games, I do not play games. Oh, wait, that's a card game. I like card games. Oh, okay. I'll try this game too. Okay, we got to play one more round.
Yeah. My mom, I think when we say play games, she thinks board games that have to have a board. And I don't know what's in her head because it's not like we've gotten her to play Catan to know what modern board games are like. But as soon as it's a deck of cards, he's off and good to go. So that was pretty awesome. So the first of the two games we tried is Flip 7. This one's from the op. This was a surprise to us because it showed up with our review copy of Gnome Hollow, which, I can't wait to get to Gnome Hollow, but that's still in the pile of obligation. This is a dead simple card game, and it uses that Dalmoody deck, as I like to call it, but those decks where you have 1-1, 2-2s, all the way up to 12-12s. I don't know. There's got to be a name for that type of deck, but I'm going to call it the Dalmoody deck because that's the first time I've seen it. Everyone gets a card, and then it's kind of like blackjack, right? So you get one of those cards, and then you either hit or stay. If you end up getting two of the same card, you bust out. Otherwise, you keep going until everyone stays or everyone busts. Or if you get to seven cards, and that's where that flip seven comes in, right? If you were able to get seven cards in front of you, you get a bonus. And then you just add up your points. You play to 200. And then to make things interesting, there's some cards that are just worth bonus points, and there's some special actions. It's neat. Like, it's quick. It's rapid playing. I think it's going to be a big hit.
I don't have too much to say about this game. I found it way too simple, far too random, and kind of boring. I get the whole there are more 12s than anything else thing and trying to play the odds. Some of that is clever, but for me, overall, meh.
So you're looking at a triangular deck of cards is the proper term for the 1-1, 2-2s, 3-3s, 4-4s.
All right, cool enough. I figured there had to be a term for it. There had to be a name for this type of deck. Though at this point, there's so many games that are starting to use it. Like, it almost would be like playing cards. Like, can I just go buy one triangular deck and play all these different games with it? It is kind of getting to that point. Now, this one's dead simple to teach. It went over pretty well the first game. Most impressive part to me about this is you get the game and it says on the box, player count 3+. I'm like, okay. So then I open it up and there's this little call out that says, if you have 18 or more players, you will require a second copy of the game. 18 or more players. I'm like, holy cow, that is pretty impressive. I'm like, all right, that's neat. And I got to say, I wish I had this back in the day when we were going to the Knights of Columbus and like the large game groups we had together there for like birthday parties of mine and stuff like that. I thought that was neat. I think this is going to be a big hit at our public play events. Now, we did break it out the next day during our Thanksgiving gaming day with the kids. And it went even better. And what I found really made the game was those special cards. It wasn't just, you know, cheesy blackback. And having those and being able to play them on other players added that level of decision making I liked. That gave me that just enough control that it didn't feel too random to me.
So you guys played it at three and you really enjoyed it at three was the gist I got. Yeah, I know Gwen was immediately excited at the concept of bringing this to her high school board game club because they've been getting larger groups showing up and she's been looking for simple games that can play with large numbers of people. So an easy to teach game that plays up to 17 had her super excited. She brought it with her this week, but I don't think it hit the table.
Nah, it didn't. Now, for a more detailed look at Flip 7, we will be doing a review later in the show. Next, the other new card game is Mind Up. This one's from Pandasaurus Games. This one was a gift for anyone who went to Pandasaurus's booth at Gamma Expo and did a demo, which we did. Now, the demo was for Courtesans, which looks fantastic. Check out Courtesans. But for checking out Courtesans, they're like, here, you get a copy of Mind Up. Fair enough. This is a very clever card game that I would say is quite a step up from Flip 7, a little more detached from traditional card game and doesn't just feel like gamers backgammon. Here you have a single deck of cards numbered 1 to 60, and that's split over 5 colors, and we still haven't figured out quite how the colors are distributed, but I do know there's an equal number of each somehow. Now, players get a hand, and a number of cards are flipped up from the deck equal to the number of players, and you sort them in numeric order. Then everyone's going to take a card from their hand and play it face down. You reveal them, then you sort those in numeric order and put them under the cards on the table, and everyone takes the card that they played under. So, like, if whatever, you put them in numeric order, you get to claim one of the cards from the table. Scoring's unique because you're getting points for sets of the same colored card where the numbers don't matter. And you're also, the order you draft the colors in matters. And I don't know how to explain this without getting into full rule teach, which I don't want to do because we are doing a full review of this one later. But basically, your first color collected is going to score points. Your second color goes in a new column. Your third color goes in a new column. If you collect all five colors, you're going to have five columns. Well, the value of those columns randomizes every game. So like one turn, your first, it might be like 1, 3, 2, 5, 4. And then, you know, your first column scores 1, your next one scores 3, the next one 2, then 5, then 1. The next game, 5 might be first, so you might want to just get a first color. The next game, the 1 and 2 could be in the 4th and 5th spots. You really don't even want a 5th color, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, there's a lot going on here, and I dig it. And it's neat the way that the numbers on the cards only matter for when you're bidding and not for when you're placing them in front of you in your tableau. Then only the color matters. Like there's a lot of neat things going on here.
Yeah, and you're saying the numbers don't matter once they're in your tableau, but then there's a neat trick where your next hand is your tableau. You pick up your entire tableau and then use it to bid next round. So there's just a lot more going on in this game. The drafting reminded me a bit of Shikoku, that weird racing game where you lose if you're in first and last place. But the rest of the game's not really similar to that, but just that way you were drafting and taking cards based on the number you were in. And this is one of those games that, like, you get it right from the start. Like, you just have people reveal their cards, like, okay, and I get the card above. And you're like, yeah, I get the mechanics of this game. But then once it starts... And it's super quick, but once you start playing, you start realizing more stuff, right? You start to realize just how much depth there is. Like, yeah, it seems simple. You just throw cards down, but then you're starting to remember, like, well, I know the one's been played, so I know my two will take the first card if I want it. And, you know, I've got the 60, so I know I can take the one in the end. Or you're sitting there and you're holding like the 21, the 23, and the 24, and you see someone play the 22. You now know that those cards are safe. You know, you get like those. You can start predicting which numbers other people are playing, and you can even watch what other people are drafting. And there's a lot going on. It's interesting, but like by saying a lot going on, I don't mean it's complicated either.
No, and knowing that the cards you're drafting are going to become your hand, you don't want 21, 22, 23. You want a widespread.
Yes.
Because if you have only all high-end numbers, or you don't want all low-end numbers, you want a spread that lets you bid flexibly while you're picking up your cards next round. I said, it's so many things that you don't have to track them all to play the game, but to play it well, there's a lot going on there.
Yeah, and I want to say this game's a card counter's dream, but like only if you're Rain Man. Like there's just way too much going on with the color distribution, the number of cards to keep in play. Like technically, at the end of the first round, you play 3 rounds, you know everyone's hand minus 1 card because you draw a card from the deck. But if you can remember, we were playing 6 people. If you can remember 6 players' hands of 8 cards each, you're doing way better than I can do. I think my dad would love this game because the amount of card counting that does matter. But most likely, you're going to remember those key numbers.
Now, then, there's the number and the color as well. Yeah. And you're unlikely to remember the number, the color. Does it have a plus or a minus on it? I sure as heck am not keeping all that in my head. I got better things to think about.
Plus, I also feel you could just be half paying attention and play. And I don't think you'd do terrible.
The colors the 5 colors repeated 12 times.
Yeah, but like, is it odd numbers are always green? Is there any pattern to it is what we couldn't figure out.
Does as far it as I start can tell, 1, 2, 3, 4?
It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Right, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Yeah, 6, but 7, then, 8, 9, then 10. One color would always be a multiple of 5, and it's not. Because I checked that. I'm like, is 5, 10, 15, 20 all the same color? Nope. So I don't think it is that. I think it might be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1. Like, I don't know.
They don't mention it in the rules, so I don't know.
Yeah, I know. It's not
nobody
that's part of system mastery. Maybe eventually we'll learn. Now, we are going to be doing a full review of Mind Up tonight. So enough about it for now. Now, what I do want to talk about, since it's not going to come up during the individual game reviews, is how these two games compare, because we did happen to play them both in the same night and then the next day, like in a short period of time. And I got to say, I liked both pretty much equally. Because I think Flip 7 is going to be great for public play. I think it's going to be an awesome game for us to have to bring out to our Walkerville Brewery game nights. I think it's going to be great for a beer and pretzel game night. It's going to be good for a late night game during Extra Life 3 in the morning game. because it's just that little bit of thinking. There's just a take a hit or not, trying to do a bit of basic math. I think it'll be a good New Year's game night after many beers. I just so simple. Like, I literally take the deck, shuffle it. I'll teach to play as we're playing. Here's a card. Do you hit or not? Note, there's 12 12s, 11 11s, 10 10s. So that's going to affect your odds. You can play it super casually, or you can play the odds and make educated guesses. And the game works both ways. I think it's going to be very popular. I also think Gwen's group will enjoy it because they tend to like the sillier, lighter games. Like, she has people who still request Uno at their game nights. So I think this will be a nice next step for that group. Now, Mind Up, on the other hand, I think is a way better game. I think it's way deeper than it seems, and it's very clever. There's a lot of neat things going on there. I do feel like my decisions matter more. And with three rounds, you can even start getting into some long-term strategies with what you're, I'm going to play this just so I can try to draft it myself. Like, I'm going to play the one so I can get it back by playing the two, even if I don't need the color, just so next round I'll have the one so I have a guarantee. Like, there's all that stuff going on, and the way the scoring system changes is important too, because trying to get the right sets in the right place is not easy. You want the most of a color, but sometimes it's the third color you're collecting you want the most of, and I think that's brilliant.
I can compare these two very simply by saying I enjoyed Mind Up and would gladly play it again anytime. And I cannot say the same for Flip 7.
There you go.
Fair enough.
Now, I know. I'm just impressed with both these games. Just a couple weeks ago, we were talking about board game critique. And one of the things that came up was that listeners like to hear board game reviewers talk about games they wouldn't normally play or pick up. Well, here's two, right? These were both bonus items from publishers that we didn't ask for, and both stuck out as rather good to me. Obviously, Diana feels different. One was definitely better than the other. And I just got to say, props to the publishers for realizing these games have some universal appeal. But they're like, yeah, I know you like our heavy games, but, you know, here, we're going to slip you in a Take 7 as well.
Okay, maybe I should back that up a bit. I do not think Flip 7 is like god-awful. I just don't want to ever play it again. And I think it has a place. And I think it is, it's really neat that you can play up to 18 people. Not that we've tried that, but I could see how it would function. And you said it was fun at three. I just didn't enjoy it. That doesn't make it, I can also acknowledge it looked like a good game, just not a good game for me. And I do think it's cool that we tried out two games that we would have never, ever picked
up. Now, the next one we played is one of the newest Holiday Hijinks games. In particular, number 9? Yes, number 9. The Marriage Mix-Up. Now we're going to cover this one in depth in our review. So what I'll say here is I love the fact this one forced you to break into two teams. This is the first Holiday Hijinks game that requires two or more players. I was concerned it might be only good for two, but no, it's break into teams. And this is the first game to do that. And what I was liked about that is that the two solve the puzzles, the two teams had to work together. It has to do with everyone getting, you know, half the information and having to work with the other group to get the other half to finish it. And then you aren't actually allowed to show each other your cards. So it's all about communication. And I just thought that was a very well emphasized and very well done. And huge props to Jonathan Schaefer for still impressing me by doing something different. It's only 18 cards. Now, I will say it's not as brilliant as the Groundhog Gambit. Groundhog Gambit, to me, still wins out as the most brilliant use of 18 cards for an escape room. But this is close.
But again, like the Groundhog Gambit, it has a strong thematic tie-in and and a unique twist. He keeps managing to put a unique twist into every one of these. I watched you and our daughter play this, and I was looking at the two of you play it. And your body language, like you're leaning in close to each other, you're talking animatedly to each other. And the you know, I could tell that you're having a good time, but also that communicating and working together was integral to this game, which was just, it was neat.
The only tip I have is don't cheat. Don't pass each other cards like that. It would be way too easy.
This is not a solo game. It would be completely broken.
It would be just, you'd be like, well, yeah, you put these two together. Like some of it is like, here's three things and there's three blanks and I have the third one. You have the rest. Like if you put those two cards together, like having to describe someone, oh, I've got a word and there's a gap in the thing. And they're like, oh, wait, I've got something that has a thing, but no word. And it was a lot more interesting.
Yeah. And I think because our youngest daughter has like learning disabilities. So forcing her to communicate what was on her cards to you was an extra level that I think often she would have been like, this is too tough, I can't do this. And instead it ended up being a really interesting experience.
Yeah, and I got to say, actually, this one was really good for that because she did have a hard time describing some of the stuff. I don't want to spoil anything. But so I'll just say she had a hard time describing it. So I'd be like, okay, we need to do this. She's like, yep, we need to do this. And she's like, but I don't know how to say it. I don't know how to say it. So I had to look at it and come up with a way to go, wait, do you have anything that this, as opposed to you tell me
Do you have any letters or numbers on your card? Oh, yeah, yes, I do.
Yeah, it was right? interesting to try to find. Do you have any menu
items? You know, I heard you asking her questions like that sort of thing.
Now, the last game we played was Side Quest Nemesis, which is from a new series of escape room games that are, I can't remember where they came from, but it's overseas somewhere, that have been localized to North America by Board and Dice. And I've got to say, this is one of the most impressive escape room games I've played. Dee and I haven't even sat down to really talk about our thoughts on this, to really share it. But I've got to say, it was the most board gamey escape room game I've ever played. Like, there was punch boards and components and a standee, and we had a map, and you moved around on the map, and you there were random decks you had to draw from, and you shuffled stuff, and there were random elements. And I've got to say, this felt like it's like a new type of game. It's an escape room in a box, but it was like so much more board gamey than any other escape room in a box we've played.
Yeah, this did not feel like a twist on Exit. It felt like its own experience, right? And that at that moment when you're like, okay, we need to grab the punch board, not labeled A or Z, but the punch board that looks like a rack of goods, and punch out all the goods and then sort them and do something with them. I was like, oh, I like that. That's cool. And I mean, just overall, the game was super clever and had some unique stuff in it.
Now that one, we're going to review. I didn't pre-write this one to work
momentarily.
It in, so split the episode. We are reviewing this one momentarily, or for those of you listening at home, check out our review from last week or 3 weeks ago or whatever we're doing with Mark.
Yeah.
Nemesis, Side Quest Nemesis was awesome. I really impressed. They have put out another one that's set in the world of 7C, which I know our patron Jeff Seuss is going to be very excited about because that's one of his favorite role-playing games. I am super excited about checking that out, and I'm wondering if they're going to keep putting out more games in this series. Because, man, it was impressive. It really was.
I didn't expect much from this. It was just, it's such a small box. It didn't really look like much, and it wasn't something we sought out. It was just something we ended up taking home kind of on a whim.
Honestly. Yeah, well, and I've got to say, like, we were talking about biases in board game review, and I got to say, when someone's like, here, take this. This is our escape room game from last year. And we're like, no, that's fine. No, just take it. We got lots. Take it.
Please. They were offering multiple copies. We did not take multiple copies. We're like, please take several. Do something with them.
And I got to admit, like, that gives you that value. I'm like, well, the publisher doesn't even seem to value this that much. How good could it be?
Maybe they just wanted us all to see just how good it could be.
Yeah, maybe that's it. It was like, you know, I'm going to impress you with this and you don't know it. Maybe they're more clever than we thought. And that's it for the games we've been playing. Sorry to say Sean hasn't gotten any in. I tried to get him in on Board Game Arena, but Board Game Arena has gotten even more annoying with having to be a subscriber to invite people or whatever they're doing with their premium accounts. So
Sean's been having life. We'll force him to play games again soon.
Life happens. And now a message from our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild.
The Holiday Hijinx Master Detective Collection Kickstarter is live and already funded.
Now, we told you before about how this Kickstarter includes three new 18-card escape room games, The Leprechaun Larceny, The New Year Nightmare, and The Krampus Caper, as well as a big box to hold them all and a way to purchase the complete collection.
What we didn't know is that the all-in pledge works out to be about 50% off the retail price of buying these games. So this is a great way to get some puzzle games at a great price.
Now, the other thing Mark has announced on social media and all over the place and in his newsletters is what he is calling the Hijinx Hunt. This is a backer-only puzzle adventure that's actually part of the current Kickstarter. A puzzle in the Kickstarter about puzzle games. I think it's pretty clever. Now, as you know, we really enjoy these small pack card games. We just played one the other day, the Marriage Mix-Up. We did that on Canadian Thanksgiving and had a great time. Now, this particular one did this cool thing where you actually split into two teams and you got to work on your puzzles together, but each of you only has incomplete information. So the only way to solve it is to work with the other team. And I love that because it really showcased how important clear communication can be, which I thought tied well to the theme of a marriage game.
Yeah, it was super cool. I've got one last thing before we move on. Well, a new Kickstarter is always exciting. Don't forget that you can always save an extra 10% off on all Grand Gamers Guild existing games over on their website with code BELLHOP, B-E-L-L-H-O-P.
The cover of Flip 7 claims it's the greatest card game of all time. Could it be true? Keep listening to find out.
So the op sent us a copy of Flip 7 along with our review copy of Gnome Hollow. It's not something we requested, and we had no idea what to expect from this party game from Eric Olson. Now, in addition to the bold claim Sean's called out, the box does note it's a press-your-luck game, a race to 200, plays in about 20 minutes, and plays three or more players, ages 8 and up.
It comes in a very, very shiny metallic box that is sadly mostly air. The box contains a ridiculous cardboard insert that holds a single deck of cards. Like, this box is easily twice the size it needs to be. The game also comes with an instruction booklet, which notes that you will need a second copy of the game if playing with more than 18 players. Yes, I said 18.
The instructions are short and clear and will have you playing in no time. The card design is very elegant and easy to read with very large numbers, though they do have a right side up and are not reversible, which isn't a big deal as this is a tableau building game.
So the deck of cards is special. It's one of those decks where you get 1-1, 2-2s, 3-3s, 12-12s. It's the type we've seen in games like Bah Humbug and the 12 Games of Christmas and the classic The Great Dalmoody. Now, in this particular deck, you do get 1 to 12 in those counts. You also get 1-0, 6 bonus scoring cards, and 2 sets of 3 special cards.
Gameplay in Flip 7 is dead simple. The dealer shuffles the entire deck and then deals out cards to each player one at a time. After the initial hand, players decide if they want to stay, scoring the total of all the cards in front of them, or hit and take another card. You bust if you end up with two of the identical cards. So the round continues until either everyone busts, the last player in decides to stay, or someone manages to get 7 number cards in play, which I imagine that's where the name Flip 7 comes from. We've yet to see anyone pull it off, though.
In addition to the number cards, which score their value at the end of the round, there are 6 scoring cards that don't count towards your total of 7 cards, which score additional points, and 3 special cards that interrupt play when revealed.
So when we receive one of these cards, you choose who's affected by it, which can be you. Now, the freeze card just makes you stay. You're out for the round. You score what's in front of you. Flip 3 makes you flip up 3 additional cards, which really pushes your chances of going bust. Then there's the second chance card. You get to hold on to that one, and you can discard it along with the flipped up card when you bust, so you can keep going. Now, if you already have a second chance card, you do have to give a new one to a different player.
At the end of the round, players add up the numbers on the cards in front of them, plus any points from bonus cards. If a player ended the round by flipping up a 7th number card, they're going to get 15 bonus points. The game ends once any player tops 200 points, and then the player with the most points wins.
It sounds simple, and it really is.
Yeah, this is one of those super simple, big group games that's perfect for breaking out when you've got, you know, 12 people who insist on all playing the same game instead of splitting into 3 groups of 4 or 2 groups of 6. It's also a great light filler that works great even at low player counts, even at 3 players. That actually plays rather well. There's not really a lot of thinking required, or you could just sit back and relax or take things a little more seriously and try to play the yards and try to do some card counting. One of the interesting things in this game is the deck is not reshuffled between rounds. You only reshuffle it once you've gone through the whole time. So as that deck gets closer to the bottom, if you're paying enough attention, you may have some pretty good idea of what's left in the deck.
Yeah, the odds are interesting. A 12 is worth 12 points, but there's also 12 of them in the deck, which ups your odds of going bust. So you can make some educated guesses if you want to.
Now, the bonus for flipping seven different numbers is also pretty clever. It gives you that perfect balance point where you're really pushing your luck at that point. Once you get five or six cards, you got pretty good odds of going bust, especially if you've got like a 12 or an 11 in play. But there's always that incentive to push again just to end the round early for everyone else and get those 15 bonus points. And when we were playing three players, that came up a lot. Almost every round, someone was getting close to seven cards. And that decision of to push or stop wasn't just, am I going to bust? It's, can I get to that seven for that extra bonus?
Yeah, the one thing I thought was interesting here is you don't really care what the other people have laid out because you're just playing your own hand. There's no bonus for being the person with the highest scoring hand or the person that goes out last in a particular round. You get that bonus 15 if you manage to flip up seven numbers, yes, but there's nothing for being the best in a given round, which means you don't need to be counting up what other people at the table have or paying attention to what they have laid out, aside from if you want to know how many 11s are in play or whatever, right? Which I guess that really does make the game playable at big numbers. Like, that's how you could conceivably play this at up to 17, because you don't need to be going, okay, who has, out of all 17 of us, who scored the highest this round, right? That would bog it down. So I was surprised that it wasn't in there, but then I see why.
I got to say, you do, in my opinion, you have to pay attention to what other people have for that reason of pushing your luck, right? Doing the odds, looking around and going, okay, both fours are gone, most sevens are gone, probably not going to matter, but you're like, okay, there are four 11s out already, and that means my odds of getting 11 actually aren't as high as I thought they might be, so I might want to push.
Okay, but I don't have to look across the table and start doing math and adding up everyone's hands to see where I rank. So that's a, it speeds things up.
See, I found I was still doing that near the end of the game to figure out if the game was going to be over yet, or how, if I'm behind. So I wanted to know the score at the end of every round and go, well, I'm 20 points behind Gwen, so I have to push my luck or I'm never going to catch up.
You were clearly taking this far more seriously than
I was. Obviously. But again, that's, I think, one of the highlights of this game is they can be played both ways. You can just flip it. Like, I think this is one of those games Sean would love because we can just chat and have a beer and have fun and flip up cards and see how it goes. Or you can put the beers away and try to play a serious round, though it never gets that serious, right? This is a smart, simple game. I think it's going to be a huge hit at our Walker Brewery game nights. I think it's going to be the perfect game for public play because there's no setup time. The setup of this game, if I'm teaching this game, is I shuffle the deck and I deal you a card. We're immediately playing. It's simple rules, fast gameplay. It's the kind of game that goes great with a pitcher of beer. It's good to introduce traditional card game players because it's blackjack. It's the hit or hold, right? Mm-hmm. That mechanic, most people just know. It's already internalized. It's not often I can find a game to get my mom to play, and she ended up really loving this game, and she even noted that she wished we had this game when we used to have big parties at the local Knights of Columbus.
Yeah, and I know Gwen is really excited about the prospect of bringing this one to her high school board game club. It's quick, it's simple to teach, and it can accommodate large groups, which makes it perfect for the one-hour slot they have for club game time.
Yeah, this is definitely right in there with my kind of beer and pretzels game, as it's often called. And I see a lot of people who have played this are saying the same thing. You know, the folks who got it at Gen Con and got it at Essen are saying, you know, this is light. This is beer and pretzels. One thing I want to note, we did call out the fact that the box has a lot of empty space in it. Interestingly, all the people who received the promo edition from Gen Con or Essen, it's just a tuck box. It's just a deck of cards. So it's only for the retail version that they needed to try and, you know, make their space on the shelf and add that extra air in there.
Yeah, and which also gets to the whole the greatest card game of all time. I'm like, I love you, the op. Like, I love your games, but like, you're trying a little hard here with the shiny. Like in a way, I get it because it's a solid game. I enjoyed it. And I think they're like, look, you really do want to try this, I think is what they're trying to get out there. But this is not the greatest card game of all time for me. It's a solid game. I'm quite happy the op sent it to us. I got to admit, seeing this on the store shelf, I know it's shiny and all the things, but that would not draw me in. I would have skipped over this one on store shelves. But now that I have it and I played it, I'm very happy to have another simple card game that plays a wide player count well. It's not just that you can play 17 people with this box. It's the fact that it also plays well at three. I really appreciate that. Now, I do have to say props to the op for realizing the game does have some universal appeal and, like, honestly, taking the chance to send it to us. Like, this is not something we asked for. It just showed up.
Mm-hmm. The greatest game of all time is a lie, a blatant lie. it's false advertising. The box, honestly, I get why they went with a big, shiny box to try and get your attention in the store. But I think it does a disservice because a tiny tuck box would have intrigued me more and let me know this is a traditional card game sort of size and shape and probably has a traditional card game kind of thing going on inside it. Also, the super metallic box is really hard to read in some spots, but that's another issue.
In my opinion, if you enjoy push your luck style card games, you're going to love this. This is your jam, right? Like, if you enjoy games that use a pyramid deck that we now found out what they're called. One of those decks, we have 1/1, 2/2s, and so on. This is a cool one for that style of deck. If you're a blackjack fan, but want something a little less serious where you're probably not throwing any money down, I think you'll have fun with Flip 7. If you like Dead Man's Draw, this has another similar feel. That push your luck, flip it up, oh, I bust. That feeling, if you enjoy that feeling in a game, that push your luck, can I do it? If you have that experience, that's what you want, you're going to like this. Also, if you have game nights, I have, like, you know, 8 people show up and they don't want to play a party game. They're not interested in telestrations. They don't want to play headbands. They want to play a game. I think this is great because it plays 17 people with one box. Now, if you don't like highly luck-driven games, games where you can lose even if you do nothing wrong, or just prefer card games where you get to outplay your opponents, you can probably skip this one.
And with that, I think we're going to stay. If we gave you any more information on Flip 7, we may just bust. So I think we're good.
It seems like there are more and more games coming out using a special deck with card counts matching their face value. What's your favorite of the bunch? Let us know. Let me know at Sean@tabletopbellhop.com. Comment wherever you found this review or tell us on the Tabletop Bellhop Discord at discord.tabletopbellhop.com. Mind Up is a unique card drafting game where you are trying to play the right numbered card to get you the colored card you want. It's a game that will appeal to traditional card gamers as well as hobby board gamers.
So Mind Up was designed by Maxime Ramberg and originally published in 2023 by French publisher Catch Up Games. It was localized by Pandasaurus Games, who gave us a copy for doing some demos of their games at Gamma Expo.
This clever card game plays 3 to 6 players, with games taking well under half an hour and being quicker to lower the player count. It's listed as ages 8+, but we could see some younger kids being able to play as well, as there's no reading required.
The card deck in Mind Up consists of cards numbered 1 to 60 coming in 5 different colors. Each color also has an associated symbol to help tell them apart. The game comes in a nice small box with a set of fold-out 2-sided instructions. The instructions are simple and well presented. This is one of those games where it's not a terrible idea just to crack it open on game night, read the rules out loud or summarize them, and get playing.
So Mind Up is played over 3 rounds of card drafting, where you will score points based on the number of cards you have in each set of cards of the same color, with each player being able to collect up to 5 different colors. Now, the value of each set is based on the order you draft each color in and does change every round.
I will note, when it's randomized in a way that it's the same for everyone at the table. It's not asynchronous. Setup is simple. You shuffle the deck and deal each player 7 cards, then flip up a number of cards equal to the player count into the center of the table and arrange them in ascending order. Then one player shuffles their 5 scoring cards and places them left to right in front of them, and every other player then plays down their scoring cards in the exact same order.
Each turn, players select 1 card from their hand to play and put it face down on the table, revealing them when every player has selected 1 card. These cards are then sorted in numeric order and placed under the set of cards in the center of the table.
At this point, every player claims the card that was already on the table above their selected card. So everyone gets 1 card. These are then played into each player's tableau. Now, the first time you draft a card of a color, it has to go in the leftmost tableau, on the leftmost open scoring card. Now, if you draft a card of a different color it's got to go into the next open spot. Now, if you draft a card of the same color you already have, it just stacks on top, So you're making groups of the colors, so you only have one group of each potential color.
Play then continues with the set of cards just played being the new set of cards that everyone is now drafting for. Everyone continues to play one card each, sort them, and then claim the cards above until everyone is down to just one card. That final card gets played into your tableau as if you just drafted it, and then everyone scores their cards.
Each scoring card lists a number from 1 to 5. This is how many points you get for each card stacked on that scoring card, which will all be the same color. In addition to this, some cards give bonus positive or negative points, which are added or subtracted to get your final score for the round.
And the next round begins by picking up your tableau. You pick up all of your cards, draw one new card from the deck, and start playing again. Someone randomizes the scoring cards, and everyone else arranges their scoring cards, so that changes every round. And play continues, with the face-up cards at the end of last round being the face-up cards for the start of the new round. Game ends at the end of the third round, and the player with the most points wins.
Game also includes an advanced mode that uses a set of bonus cards. These are revealed at the start of each round and give players bonus points for fulfilling goals on them. The goals are things like having a specific number of a specific color of cards, having the most of one color out of all of your cards, being the player with the most of a color, etc.
Mind Up is a delightfully simple game to play that features more depth than you would expect. When you first start playing, you're not quite sure what you're doing, and it feels pretty random. But then you start realizing how much control you actually have and how important picking what number to play matters. Now, this is combined with the rather unique scoring system, where sometimes you're going to want the most of the first color you draft, and other times it might be the fourth color you collect that's going to be worth the most points.
The way that the scoring columns are randomized each game makes each round feel fresh. Yeah.
And the scoring system is only part of the game, is one part of the game that does take players a bit to get used to. One of the things to note, and this is the thing I think our group had the biggest problem with, is thinking the numbers matter. Well, the numbers don't matter when it comes to scoring, because it just matters how many cards are stacked together. How many blues do you have? How many reds do you have? How many, or there's no red, how many orange, how many purple? That's all that actually matters. And then what scoring card they're under. But then the numbers do matter when you're drafting. So you do still have to pay attention to the numbers, but that's not what scores you points.
Right. I think your mom, coming from a traditional card background, really had the hardest time with that. When we had to explain it to her a couple times, she kept going, okay, but a 52 has to be better. And I'm like, only for when you draft, not here.
And, yeah. And it's not to say better. It just means you're probably going to draft cards further to the right, like further down the column.
Right, because that whole thing where the cards that you have in your tableau end up, you pick them up and they become your hand, it turns out you want a spread of numbers. You don't want all high or all low, because then your choices are really limited when you're drafting later.
Now, this is also a great game that can be played casually or taken seriously. Like, card counting will help, but honestly, there's 60 cards in play and there's no way you're going to memorize everything. Now, to be fair, when you do pick up your cards at the end of the round, you can theoretically know exactly what's in everyone else at the table's hands, including your own, except for that one card drawn from the deck. But I don't know anyone that good at counting cards to keep track of all that. Plus, you're looking at the bonuses on the cards, the card numbers, the color of the cards. What's going to actually happen is, if you are taking the game seriously, you're going to pay attention to like the lowest and the highest cards are, watch for runs, and as Deanna said, making sure you get a diverse number of cards.
Yeah, there is. I may remember that the 60 is already in play, but there's Esmo pointed out, there's the color of the card, there's a number on the card, and then there's plus minus points on the cards. There's no way I'm remembering who has what where. I've got better things to be thinking about. Maybe there's somebody out there that's going to have all that in their head, but.
And as we actually discovered earlier, the coloring is not as straightforward as you would think. So while 1, 2, and 3 are orange, pink, and green, or orange, pink, and blue, and 4 is green, the fifth color is actually starts at 7.
So,
That's
next level play. We have not gotten to the point where we played Mind Up enough to figure out the color sequence, and I think that's in purpose. Like, I think it does not go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There is an equal number of all the colors. There's 12 of each, But that's something else you might want to count. Like if you're going for the most blues, you can look around the table and count how many blues and figure out your odds of blues. But then if the blue comes up and it's a 55 and your highest card in your hand's a 32, you aren't getting that blue.
Right. And it's not like all the blues are even, all the greens are odd. Correct. Like it's a mix.
Yeah, I'm not sure where the playtesting went into that, but I think they did a good job. Now, there's also actually some strategy in this game. Like, yes, there's a lot of tactical play, but because you are picking up your own tableau, you may draft numbers knowing you'll have them in your next hand. So there is that little bit of foreplanning. And again, you're probably not going to memorize anything, but like you might play low just to take a card so that you have it for next round. That is part of the game. And then there's also a way you can play where you're chasing the bonus points, because as we mentioned, not all of them, and this is something else, I don't know how the distribution's figured out, but some cards have minus points and some have plus points on them, which is worked into the math when you're scoring. Well, having to draft a plus two card or a plus three card and putting it into your 1 point spot isn't so bad. Of course, it's better in your five, but you're not going to feel so bad when that fifth color that's only worth 1 point has a plus two on it or a plus three.
And getting a minus one is okay if it ends up in your five column. Right. Yeah, and then there's also that part where you want to try and make sure that the one you reserve as your last card to play maybe has some bonus points on it, or is going to end up in a column that has a high number on it. And you can't always control that because you don't know what colors are going to end up in what rows, and or even if you're going to have all the colors, right? And particularly at the beginning when you're starting with a random hand, not a hand that you've drafted yourself.
But even then, the color of the cards in your hands does not help you draft colors. Not like playing a blue helps you at all. It's only the number on the card that matters for drafting. Mm-hmm. So even having a bunch of diverse colors in your hand doesn't really help you.
But I found that it helped in having a greater chance of having the card that I want to hold back for the end round be something good.
Yes. And then there's the thing, if you got lots of blues, you put the blues out to hope to draft your own blues back.
And then you throw in the bonus objectives and there's a whole other.
Yes, exactly. That's a whole other layer. And I got to say, I do like the way the scoring cards work. Like that, to me, that adds a level to this game. Like the game didn't need that. You could just score, you know, whatever, 1 point for your first color, 2 points for your second, three for your third color. Like the game would have worked with that, but I really like the way it moves. And it adds a level to the game where you might just want to stick to one color. If you're fives in that first spot, you're going to try to draft as many of that color as you can. You're just going to get, you know, all 70 of your cards are going to be your color, that color. Yeah, well, good luck with that for one. But then the next time you play, the highest scoring cards might be in that fourth and fifth slot. So you're like, I want to draft a couple of colors just to get them out of the way, just so I can get to the good ones. And then other players are playing with the exact same restrictions. And one of the big ones we found came out playing it the next day was looking around the table and going, oh, geez, four other people are already collecting green in their five slot. Let's not draft a green for there. Like, so there's like just all these like neat levels to this game for what's really a basic drafting game where you play cards, put them in order, and then take the matching card above it. Like the mechanically, it's so simple.
But with the drafting, you don't always end up with what you want.
No,
you're blind bidding on that drafting.
Yes.
And you frequently end up with, I didn't even want a third color. Darn it. Yes. You know, now I have to adapt to that. Right. So.
And one of the great feelings in the game, which was goes like both negative and positive, when you're like, I played a five, I am getting that first one. And then the next player plays a four, then a one, then a two. And you end up taking the last dang card and you get like a 60 and like the color you don't need at all. And that is just, in my opinion, a great feeling, even when it's negative. It's just that's fun. You're like, I got this for sure. Oh, no, you don't. Now, the other thing that I do like about this is, yeah, it's deep and it's got all this stuff going on, but like the basic mechanics are dead simple. Like you could play this totally casually and can be enjoyed with younger kids. There is a high random factor. This is a card game. You're drawing from a deck. You don't know exactly what's going to happen. I know local gamers that will play this game and will randomly select a card from their hand and put it on the table. I know they will. There are certain people I know that will add that chaos to the game and it's not going to break anything. And because of that, I think this is a great game for a variety of groups or even for the same group on different game nights. Like we're sitting down, we're going to play tonight. Let's play some Mind Up in between before starting, a Vital Lacerda game. But then, you know, let's go meet up at the pub on Friday and play a game. They're going to be both very different games with the same group of people. I can totally see breaking this out as a filler on a heavy game night, as well as taking it out once half in the bag on New Year's.
I think it's super simple to teach, and maybe that's not coming across here. And I have to emphasize that we played this with Mo's mom, who is not a gamer, and she completely understood it from the first round and was able to play it because it was that simple to explain, and the basic steps made sense.
Yeah, I don't think necessarily our description written and spoken word fully gets it across. I do recommend, if you are interested, head over to Board Game Geek. You can download a copy of the rules. It's just 2 pages right there on the files from Board Game Geek. And literally, as you're scrolling down it the first time, you go, oh, of course. Yes.
Yeah.
Got it. Totally get it, because it really is that straightforward.
Yeah, I hate when we have to say it's not as complicated as it sounds, but it really is
truly
as it sounds. The other thing you can do is you can go to Board Game Arena and play it for free with strangers. Now, if you do have a premium account, you can invite people to your table to play. So you can play this on Board Game Arena as well. Now, what I have to say is thank you, Pandasaurus. Like, totally out of the blue. Like, this was honestly used as an incentive for us to check out their other games at a convention, but I ended up being a big hit. Like this was the Thanksgiving hit. This was the game that everyone was like, wow, we got to play that some more. And again, it included my mom, who's almost impossible to get to the game table. And I could actually sometimes win her over with a card game, but this worked great for that. This is the one my mom's like, can we play another round? Can we play again? Like, I know the kids have school tomorrow, but can we fit in just one more?
You know, I think incentive is the wrong word, because that implies that we went to seek it out and did a demo so we would get this. It was more like they were doing a demo, and they said, oh, everyone that does a demo with us gets a copy of Mind Up. And we went, oh, I've never had no clue about this game. What is this? I didn't think I wanted it. I didn't know what it was. Yep. And it is a pleasant surprise. So the last round of drafting is done, and it's time to total our scores. I think we did pretty well in this round of card game reviews. It was fun checking out some card games we may have missed out on otherwise, as well as reviewing a couple of games we didn't pick out ourselves.
Personally, I love these kind of light, you get to socialize and hang out while you're playing style of games. What's one of your favorite beer and pretzel games? Games with enough depth to be interesting, but that don't require that total focus to play.
Hit us up on social media. Let us know. Post a comment wherever you found this review. Email us, Mo, D, or Sean at tabletopbellhop.com.
Well, that was the double bell.
That means our shift's coming to an end, and we're going to have to lock the lobby doors.
Before we start locking things down, let's take a moment to thank a selection of our Tabletop Bellhop Patreon patrons. Derek Kissen. Thank you, Derek.
Hey, folks over at the Misdirected Mark, thank you for your support.
Donna, thanks, Pax.
Thank you, Evil John.
Mr. Kurtz, one of our many Bryans, thank you for being the first.
Chris Leary, thank you.
I want to jump here. Among
Bryans.
I want to jump in here and say an extra special thank you to Chris Leary for actually sending us feedback on our new format. It was super appreciated.
Well, your first stop to finding us should be at tabletopbellhop.com, but you can find us all over the web as Tabletop Bellhop, one word, and on your podcatcher of choice as the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
Once again, the single thing we would love most in the universe is a review. If you enjoyed the show, please head over to Spotify, Pandora, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you're listening, leave us a review, and help other people find the show.
And if you dig the content we create, you can show your support through our Patreon, becoming one of our patrons, where you do get some cool bonus stuff, or over at Ko-fi, which is ko-fi.com. Just head over there and search Tabletop Bellhop on either platform. That's all for us tonight.
For the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, I'm Sean.
I'm Deanna.
And I'm Mo.
Thank you.
And game on.